I've been through so many storms in my life. And the same thing he did for me, he is wonderful, beautiful. Something about the name of Jesus. See, there's healing in the name of Jesus. Jesus, he's my provider. He's my healer. Jesus, help me call a name.
Jesus, 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 Jesus. John chapter 1. Hallelujah. The more you call him, the better he'll make you feel. Something about that name of Jesus. Chapter 1 from the English Standard Version. I want to read for your hearing verse number 14. Let us pray. God, we thank you for this day, this time of sharing. Thank you for this wonderful, indescribable, supernatural, awesome gift that you've given in the person of your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. We thank you for this season of Advent. And wherever there's a Bible learning, Bible loving, Bible living church, we pray, Lord God, that you would add to their ranks laborers as we minister through messages about Advent. We thank you for the perfect gift in Jesus. Help us, oh God, to be lucid in our language, discipline our deliberations, exceptional in exegesis, wise in our words, true to the text, salient in the sermon, while these your people are receptive as well as responsive to your holy word. We pray, oh God, in the name of Jesus, that you would add to the body of Christ such as should be saved and convince, convict, and convert into the conformity of Christ. We thank you for what you have done, and we're trusting you for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen. John 1 and 14, just one verse we want to lift today as we revisit a very important message for us to consider again on today. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory. Glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. Just for a little while, I want to agree with the voice of Messiah today and talk on this topic, God's greatest gift to the world. God's greatest gift to the world. Brothers and sisters, many of you have shopped, patronized a certain kind of retail establishment called a White Elephant store. Or perhaps you had the opportunity to participate in a white elephant sale. The term white elephant is a historical idiom for a valuable but burdensome possession of which its owner could not dispose of, and the cost particularly of upkeep is out of proportion to its usefulness or its worth. Term is derived from a story of the kings of Siam, which is now referred to as Thailand, that were accustomed to make a present of one of these animals, the elephant, to courtiers who had rendered themselves obnoxious. In other words, they tried to pass them off on people who were getting on their nerves. They did this in order to ruin that individual because they knew that the cost of upkeep or maintenance of an elephant is extremely high. The grocery bill, let's say, for an elephant has to be quite expensive because they eat all day long and they can eat several pounds of food in a single day. In modern usage, this term talks about or deals with objects or schemes, business ventures, facilities, etc., that are considered to be without use or value. It's wise to keep in one respect, but it's also a two-edged sword. If you can get rid of it, then it's also wise to do that as well. This term again is described to and derived from the sacred white elephants that were kept by the South Asian monarchs in Burma, Thailand, Laos, and Cambodia. To possess a white elephant was regarded as, and it's still regarded in Thailand and in Burma, as a sign that a monarch reigned his justice, his town, his kingdom with absolute power, and that the kingdom was blessed with both peace and prosperity. The tradition derives from tales which associate a white elephant with the birth of the Buddha, so it's already idolatrous. And his mother that had reputed him, and because she dreamed of a white elephant that handed her with its trunk a lotus flower the night before he was born. So to them, it is a symbol of wisdom as well as purity. Now, because the animals, the elephants, the white elephants, who are rare, were considered sacred, and the laws protected them from doing labor, they couldn't push anything, pull anything, carry anything. They were received as gifts from monarchs, and to the recipient, it was simultaneously a blessing and a curse. To receive the gift was a blessing because it says that the monarch thought of you, even though ill-intentioned in the back of the monarch's mind somewhere. But it was a curse because, again, it was quite expensive to feed an elephant. Amen. And so it would normally almost bankrupt a person who did not have the means to sustain such a significantly large animal as an elephant. In the 19th century, the phrase became commonplace in conventional uses at church bazaars, white elephant sales, or otherwise, where donors could unload their unwanted stuff, gently used but valuable articles that were impractical. They could unload them, generating profit from the sales that usually get donated to charitable causes, to non-profit causes, or to make life a little better for the disenfranchised. And it comes from the ideology that one man's treasure is another man, well, one man's trash is another man's treasure. There you go. In general use, a white elephant usually refers to an item that's not useful, however elaborate or decorative that it might be, but it can prove to be expensive and odd at other times. To this, I would add that many are forced to disregard the white elephant gift altogether. We look at this particular chapter in the Gospel of John. The first 18 verses of this chapter marks this gospel as a prologue to the incarnation of Jesus Christ. This particular season is what many scholars, theologians, and some other denominational groups consider as Advent, or the celebration of the time of Jesus' coming, his first coming that had been prophesied from the days of old and heralded by the preachers of the Old Testament and anticipated by those who had studied and searched out the scriptures for the things of God. This thing came to pass even after God had no longer spoken to man for 400 years, and it was foretold as early as the ministry beginning with John the Baptist. When they both were born and grew up, John the Baptist said, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And then shortly thereafter, Jesus begins his public ministry. But here, this time is when Jesus was born, what we celebrate as Advent. But Advent cannot have occurred without what many of us go to Sunday school, come to Wednesday night classes or Wednesday afternoon classes, Monday morning classes, have heard of: this church word, this word that has been introduced in the body of Christ as incarnation. And that is the word becoming flesh. We learned that in the first verse of John's Gospel, chapter 1. It says, "In the beginning, God the Word was God, and the Word was with God, and same was in the beginning. All things were made by him. There was not anything made that was not made without him," right? And so the Word became flesh, because in the beginning was the Word, and that Word was not just something written or spoken. It was the personality of Jesus Christ, God's Word, the embodiment of it. So this incarnation, according to Easton's Bible Dictionary, a very popular Christian publication that many refer to, says that it is the act of grace whereby Christ took our human nature into union with his divine nature and person. He became a man, more essentially put. Christ is both God and man. Human attributes and actions are predicated of him, and he of whom they are predicated is God. A divine person basically was united with a human nature. That's how it happened. A divine person was united with a human nature. This union is called a hypostatic union. In other words, it is personal, and it continues in the fact that the two natures are not mixed or confounded. So he's a God man, 100% God and 100% man. And the two can be distinguished. He was 100% man because he got tired and he went to sleep. But he's 100% God when he said, "Come unto me and I will give you rest." He's 100% man because he ate. He ate bread. He ate loaves. We see him eating, and he was often accused of eating and drinking with sinners. But he is God because he could feed thousands with fish and loaves, and that he could turn water into wine at the wedding season. So we know that he was both God and man. So this union was personal, but it was also perpetual. And beginning with verse 1, John states the eternal and essential deity of Christ. And that's a key statement that's made here in the verse that we are considering today, verse number 14, where John emphasizes the mystery of the incarnation is now revealed to us. The fact that the Word now assumed a new form of existence. Now, there was a unity of the Lord's person before and even after the incarnation. He did not cease to be God before the incarnation. He does not cease to be God, certainly now, after the incarnation, the death, burial, and the resurrection. He is God, but he just took on human nature. He's the second person of the Godhead in his incarnation. God the Son, we refer to him as. But at the same time, his humanity was both real and complete. Again, he tired, he hungered, and he even died in our place as a substitutionary sacrifice, the Paschal Lamb, whereby he would take away the sins of the world. He remained the same person as before, but he became flesh. Becoming flesh did not remove him from his state of holiness. It did not detract from his divinity at any time. The humanity of the Lord Jesus was not something to be temporarily assumed, and even Paul would suggest something to be grasped at. and then later discarded. It expressed a new form of existence, an existence that no cannot be told of any other than Jesus Christ. A lack of understanding these truths on part of unbelievers served to provide a basis on which to close themselves off from the Christ of Christmas. That's why it's easy for people to take Christ out of Christmas, not knowing who he is, not appreciating the incarnation, how God, for our sake and our benefit, became like us so that we could become like him. Theologian Dr. Bruce Emmert says that they take on either one, two, or three characteristics, either pride, either power, or either pacification. That's where unbelievers sit, in either one of those three categories. And I've told you this before, power, pride, or pacification. The proud, well, this group has their hearts closed off to what God is trying to give them. As an interactive illustration, we've done this before, I believe, but some of you probably forgotten. It's been so long. Just fold your arms in front of you. In a picturesque form, your hearts are now closed off to things. You know, when we not feeling something, what do? Impulsively, instinctively. We fold our arms and we tilt our head. Yeah, you've done that before. That means you shutting down or you shutting off, you closing off something. You know when your kids come cooking up that story, where you been, all that stuff. Yeah, you know that look. That's that proud look. In a sense, unbelievers do this to God and they close off their hearts to the things that God is trying to give them. But then there's the powerful. This group of people, they raise their powerful fists of independence, refusing to surrender because they consider themselves too self-sufficient to need a savior. So everybody make a fist, raise it up high, like you black, you proud. I mean, it just feels powerful, doesn't it, when you do it like that? Amen. In the same way, the unbeliever holds up that fist in defiance of the fact that he or she needs to surrender to God, and they're not only hard-headed, but more essentially put, hard-hearted. And that's why the scriptures has to tell people at other times, the day you hear the Lord's voice, harden not your heart, as they did in the day of provocation when they tempted God. And so don't be proud and don't be powerful thinking that you don't need a savior. Because the hymnologist says it like this, in times like these, that's the very thing you need, is a savior. In times like these, you need to be sure that your anchor holds and that it grips the solid rock. And who's that rock? That rock is Jesus. If he had not been incarnated, he could not be our solid rock. And because he bequeathed power, because he left power, he held his power in cessation so that we could be saved. So how dare we stand and consider ourselves too sufficient to need a savior? So we've got the proud, there's the powerful, but then there is the pacified. The group of the pacified, brothers and sisters, has difficulties receiving God's gift, often because they have made themselves too comfortable to think that they need them. A self-pacification, when you find yourself too comfortable to think that you need God's gifts. People that pacify themselves are, we've already hugged ourselves, we've already extended our powerful fists, so now just start rubbing yourself and petting yourself and, you know, primping yourself and, you know, just make yourself feel good, you know, tickle yourself, you know, scratch where it is. That's pacification, when you immediately attend to those needs of self. That's pacification, right? If you don't allow somebody else, or if you don't commission anyone else to pacify you, you will begin to pacify yourself, right? And so again, this group makes it too comfortable for them to think that they need God. You think you can satisfy yourself. Amen. I don't need anybody to do for me. Some of you are brazen enough to say that. But you start crying when somebody don't speak to you. Amen. So I don't need nobody. But you can't even stand a person not acknowledging your presence. But just the same, all of us at times tend to self-pacify. But God, he knows how to get through the proud. He knows how to get through the powerful. He knows how to get through those who pacify, because the doctrine of election has called each of us into salvation. But there are unbelievers who will not accept God on his terms, denying the fact that the gift that he received, if accepted, is all that we need in order to be saved. So if any of these categories describe us today, then that means that you won't accept God's gift in your heart, because it's either closed off. You can't receive God's mercies if your hand is clenched in power. And you certainly won't want God's grace if in your head you are too cozy in your spiritual condition. You can only receive a gift either when your heart, your heads, or your hands are open. Because if your mind's closed off to it, you'll reject it. If your heart's closed off to it, you'll reject it. If your hands are closed off to it, you're rejected. If you're proud today, get rid of your pompousness. If you think yourself powerful, remember the one who's all powerful. And forget about those pretenses in which you have. If you're pacified, maybe you need to let go of some of your perks that pacify you, because these things tend to get in the way of the gift of God. And in your case, if you're such, they'll end up white elephanted. The gift of God will end up white elephanted. And so for the next little while, there are timeless truths that are trapped within the treasury of this text that are tailored to teach us the proper perspectives pertaining to Jesus' person and work in the Godhead, or the Trinity, as more commonly described, and helping unbelievers to contend that Jesus is not the world's greatest guru. He's not the world's greatest gaffe, in the opinion of some. But by faith, we contend him to be the world's greatest gift. Period. Amen. The world's greatest gift, period. And that leads me to my first point. He is the greatest gift by venue of where he was placed. Hallelujah. Some of y'all think the best gift you ever received, you found it early one Christmas morning underneath the tree. Hallelujah, somebody. Jesus Christ is the greatest gift by venue of where he was placed. The text says, and the word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory. Glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. The text is literally saying that Jesus assumed the position. He came where he was most needed. You just missed your first shout. He came where he was most needed. And that was right here among men. That word dwelt in the original language means tabernacle. So he pitched a tent right here. The Jews could identify that word tabernacle. That would make them remember the tabernacle of old, where the priests worked
and offered sacrifices for men that Moses, that God told Moses to build it up and take it down when they would move and make sure that, you know, it was erected properly according to the specifications that God had made, and God would abide with them there at the tabernacle. And that's why in his incarnation we call him God with us, because just like in the Old Testament they could see the Shekinah cloud of glory over the tabernacle that told them that God was with them. And because now we have the love of Christ, of Jesus, in our hearts, and because he tabernacled during that first advent, as we refer it, we can say too that we have God with us. Because if you didn't have Jesus with us first, we didn't have Jesus with us first, we couldn't have the Holy Spirit with us, in which we enjoy now. And so we know that everything that the people needed to receive grace and mercy from God was held, was housed inside of the tabernacle. Since you missed your first shout, here comes your second one. The table of showbread was there. The Ark of the Covenant was there. The candlestick was there. All of the articles that God had told Moses to tell the craftsmen to make, you know, all of those things were there. And whenever they were used, most of the time they had to be splattered and slathered and sprinkled with blood all the time. I mean, it was a messy ordeal to be a priest in that time, because God required so much blood. Everything that was necessary for them to be forgiven was inside of the tabernacle. Here comes your shout. You've been waiting for it. Everything that was necessary for your salvation was in Jesus. Since he tabernacled with us, God knew that he had everything necessary within him in order to dispense grace unto everyone. What shouts me about that is that the tabernacle of old was only for the Jews or the Jewish proselytes. Amen, somebody. But everything that's within Jesus, you don't have to be a Jew. It's for Jews, for Greeks, for barbarians, it's for Scythians, it's for Romans, and thank God it's for those of African descent. And everyone else, everything you need, high five a neighbor and say, it's in Jesus. God's got it. The good stuff is on the inside of the tabernacle. It reminds me of a man who family had asked him to come to Christmas service with them, and the wife and the children loved to go to church, and he was a little rough around the edges, and he didn't mind them going, but he would also at all times reject their invitations. And so he looked at their worship time as time for him to relax by the fireplace. You know, that was his man cave time. Y'all go ahead to church and have a good time. Say a prayer for me when you get there, and here, put a dollar in for me when they pass the tray arounds. And so he reclines and he puts a log in the fire. He begins to watch television, and it begins to snow outside. It begins to snow and snow and snow. And as it snows, he can hear three or four thuds on his windows. Boop, boop, boop. And so this disturbs him, and he looks to see if there are children, you know, pranksters outside throwing snowballs against his picture window, and he doesn't see any kids running. He doesn't hear any laughter. So he looks and he sees that several birds were trying to fly through the storm, and because it was snowing so heavy, the flakes were so large that, you know, they ran into the window because they saw the light in the house and they thought they were running for shelter. He felt so sorry for these birds and did all he could to try to rescue them, because he had an idea. He had a shed in the yard, and he said in the shed he knew that the children, he's a wealthy man, the children's horses were in the shed. And so he said they could go in the barn. The barn's always lit. It's always warm for the other animals. So he tries to shoo them in there. They don't go. They're fluttering around on the snow-covered lawn. He tries to make a trail of breadcrumbs. that they might follow them and nibble on them and follow them into the barn where they would have security from the storm, but they don't follow them. And then other times he's trying to capture them so that he could take them personally into the barn, but every time he would try to capture one, they would elude him. And then he finally thought to himself, I'm this strange-looking creature. They're probably afraid of me, and they're probably trying to protect themselves from me when the only thing I'm doing is trying to help them. And brothers and sisters, when we resist the perfect gift of God in Jesus Christ, it appears just like that. God sent his son. The only thing he was trying to do when he tabernacled here on earth was to help us and to save us from ourselves. But oh, my brothers and sisters, we run. We're afraid. We try to elude God. He leaves a trail of breadcrumbs for us by way of his word. And oftentimes we are too afraid to cash in on the deal. But you've got to respect him as the greatest gift by the fact that he was placed here among us. Because God loves to use the same thing to get us out of trouble that got us into trouble. It was a man who got us into trouble. We call him the first Adam. But it's a man who God sent to get us out of trouble. We call him the second Adam. And so Jesus is that second Adam. And had he not come, we would still be in trouble. Touch your neighbor and say, I'm glad he came. I'm glad he came, because had he not come, we would still be in trouble. He is the greatest gift by venue of where he was placed. But then he was the greatest gift by virtue of what he presented. The word became flesh, dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory. Glory as the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. This time the text is really literally saying that we have never seen anything like this before. Now, as for Israel, they had seen a lot, and it had been written down to pass down for generations on the wonderful things that the eyes have seen, ears have heard, hearts have felt, hands have touched, noses have smelled. All of those things that God has done. I mean, Psalm 107 is a clear indication, a condensed version of the history of Israel, how good God had been to them. That's why he calls out, oh, that men would praise the Lord for his mercy and his goodness to the children of men. Every time it tells a segment of history, the psalmist declares, oh, that men would praise the Lord for his goodness and his mercy to the children of men. The Israelites had seen a whole lot from God, but they never saw it quite like this in Jesus. Ask that wedding coordinator at the wedding of Canaan that said, usually they serve the best wine first, and when the people get drunk, then they start putting the cheap stuff out. But this one then saved the best for last. That was the wine Jesus made. Amen. They never saw anything like that before. And the priests and the Sadducees and the scribes had sent a detail of temple soldiers out to arrest Jesus because they were tired of him, because he was taking their members away and people, and he was refreshing, and he oftentimes criticized them and embarrassed them in front of those who had one time revered them. They sent a detail of soldiers out, and they came back empty-handed. Didn't we tell you all to arrest Jesus? And said, why haven't you brought him back to us? They said, never a man spake like this man. Now that was low-grade shade. Why? Glad you asked, because these are temple guards. They're hearing preaching and teaching all day long. Amen. And so, in other words, that was saying, even though we stand here on guard, guarding what goes on in this place of worship, and we hear you, and we hear them, and we hear that one over there. We've never heard like Jesus before, because never seen anything like him before. That's what those disciples said. They had been on the sea, going from one side of the lake to the other all of their lives, and have always at other times encountered a storm. And this time they had Jesus on board. And then as they were saying, "We about to die," I'm sure they've said that before, Jesus gets up, steps up, speaks up, and says, "Peace, be still." And they have to tell themselves, "What manner of man is this? That even the wind and the waves obey his voice. Come here, Pilate." He was scheduled to be here, but his flight got canceled. Pontius will tell you, if he were here, that after examining Jesus, he knew that the Jews had handed him over for envy. The Bible says so. And after questioning Jesus, even though Jesus was brazen, deliberate, and forthright in his speaking, Pilate said, "I find no fault." Y'all not helping me today. "I find no fault in this man." The text is trying to tell us that there's nobody. Y'all not in here. Nobody like Jesus. Songwriter said, "You can search high and low. It doesn't matter where you go. You won't ever find nobody like the Lord." There's nobody like Jesus. You won't ever find. Why is he in a class all by himself? You ask, I love the way you ask questions here, Messiah Temple. That means you crave after the knowledge of the truth. Well, if you want the answer, it comes in the form of $3, $5 words. But I promise that they all have 5-cent meanings. They're $5 words, but they all have 5-cent meanings. The first one is homogeneous. Homogeneous. Homogeneous means that we are alike. Mankind is alike. All mankind God has created with a body, a soul, and a spirit. Man is homogeneously alike because we are tripartite. All them $5 words, Reverend, what is you talking about? I just told you what I'm talking about. That we are alike. All mankind. I don't care what race, what nationality, I don't care of your educational level, I don't care of your demographics, I don't care of your socioeconomic status, we are all mankind alike. That is what separates us from animals. We are not like them. Hallelujah, somebody. So that's the first one. Second one is heterogeneous. Heterogeneous means you have different parts that make you dissimilar. I know it sounds deep, but it's not. Men, raise your hand and put them back down. Some of y'all didn't raise your hand. I'm going to try this again. Men, males, dudes, raise your hand. Thank you. I was worried. Now, women, raise your hands. See how women follow instructions, men? That's what we want you to do next time. Now, even though men and women are considered both to be mankind, you're different. You're homogeneous, but you're also heterogeneous. Women, females are like other women. Men, males are like other men. And so we're homogeneous, but we're also heterogeneous. Jesus, my brothers and sisters, was not necessarily just homogeneous, even though he was mankind, but he was still God. He was heterogeneous to his gender, who were males, right? But unlike us who are just stuck in heterogeneology and homogeneology, Jesus was, here's the third word, monogeneous. See, when those who study genealogy, or those who study anthropology, that's the study of man, made up the words homogeneous and heterogeneous, when it came to Jesus, they had to make up another term, because he's the only one like this. And the word mono means one-sided. Amen. And so monogenous means there's only one like this. And so when you see something like he's the only begotten Son of the Father, King James, the one and only Son, NIV, and here in the ESV, the only Son from the Father, it means he is monogenous. Well, simply put, there's nobody like Jesus. Hallelujah, somebody. Can't nobody do me like Jesus. Can't nobody do me like the Lord. Can't nobody do me like Jesus. He's my friend. Pick me up. Told me to run on. He's my friend. Pick me up. Turn me around. He's my friend. Hug a neighbor and tell him, can't nobody do you like Jesus. He's in a class by himself. Some of y'all familiar with an aircraft called Air Force One. There's also Air Force Two. There's Marine One. There's Marine Two. There's Two. There's Coast Guard One. There's Executive One. I mean, he can get on a Delta flight at any airport, and because he's on it, they call that Executive One. Yeah. But the plane that carries the president, or the aircraft that carries him, is the only one that's considered Air Force One. What do you mean, Reverend? There's two aircrafts. They are both exactly the same. One is in use, and the other is just a backup. It's a backup. Because matters of the state require the president to be somewhere, he got to have his mode of transportation. And so it's just wise to have two in case the other one needs to be maintained. But it's only the one he's on that's called Air Force One. The other one is just DC-2 whatever. But if he gets off of the one he's on and gets on the other one, that one becomes Air Force One. The key is, it's only the one that he is on. And so, my brothers and sisters, isn't how we look at Jesus like that? God's residence in Jesus Christ. It's what's inside of him, God, that makes him God. But unlike the two aircrafts, the two helicopters, or whatever, it's only one Jesus. You just missed your shout. God took the guesswork out of dividing your attention or your affection from one person or another. He just put it all toward Jesus Christ. Jesus having that inner glory that John here talks about, who knew him so very intimately. That's why they call him the disciple whom Jesus loved. He saw not just Jesus, but he saw the Lord Christ. He saw God in Christ. Mark starts off by saying the beginning of the gospel of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, then gives some human details. Matthew begins with genealogies that so-and-so begat so-and-so all the way down to Jesus Christ. Even Luke starts off talking about more of the humane things that Jesus does. Him as the King of Kings, him as the suffering servant, and him as the Son of Man. But John says, wait a minute, let me put my 2 cents in it. Gives him a more higher plane, a more universal appeal. He's saying, yes, I know you see him as the Son of Man. I know you see him as the suffering servant. I know you see him as the King of Kings, but he's more than that. He is the Word of God. Become flesh. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. And then he says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. Yes, my brothers and sisters, he is the greatest gift by virtue of what he presented, but then finally, he's the greatest gift by value of what he possessed. Text here is literally saying that because of who he came from, he is full of God's love and he is full of God's light. Even though John is writing in Aramaic, it is still a Hebraism. A Hebraism are just colloquial expressions that only the Jews would make because they basically, it was inside language. But when he writes this in verse 14, it's basically saying that Jesus is the sum total of divine revelation. Because all God's word is a disclosure of himself. But God's word in print by publication is just a brief disclosure. There's no way that 66 books can tell you everything about God. If you don't believe it, go to Isaiah chapter 40. He says, haven't you heard? Don't you know that the everlasting God, the creator, the ends of the earth, doesn't get tired, doesn't grow weary. There's no searching of his understanding. You cannot comprehend him. Don't even try to collect your minds together to try to figure God out is what he's saying. You won't even come close. There's no searching of his understanding. He's incomprehensible, is what he's saying. Here, my brothers and sisters, Jesus is that incomprehensible one because he comes full of everything that is God. Jesus lets them know all the time who he was. He was not ashamed to claim himself to be deity. If they did not understand it, that was upon them. But he's the sum total of God's divine revelation, the full disclosure of who God is. God's grace corresponds with the revelation as God, as the God of love. But God's truth corresponds with the revelation, presenting God as the God of light. He's full of grace. And he's full of truth. He's full of love, and he's full of life. Now help me preach this thing by answering 2 more simple questions. What is grace? And what is mercy? Grace is God giving us what we do not deserve. You know what grace is. What is mercy? Mercy, Reverend, is God not giving us what we do deserve. And we have so much audacity to always ask God for more grace. Amen, somebody. I see you. fasting and praying, weeping and wailing. God, I just need more grace. That's audacious. That's arrogant. But because he's a loving God, he's got all the grace that you need, that you and I could even dare ask for. But don't forget, my brothers and sisters, don't get too pious. Don't get too swelled with your salvific pride, that every now and then you negate to ask God for more mercy. Because I'm sure, as for me, I don't know about you. You're a heavenly ethereal visitor that's just coming here to just remind us of what perfection is really all about. But as for me, I need mercy. I need mercy. Amen, somebody. I need God to withhold what I do deserve. Amen, somebody. Next time you cuss somebody, I'll say, Lord, have mercy. Next time you pull up in front of that house, Lord, have mercy. Can we be real here today? Hallelujah, somebody. On their job, you need to be asking God, Lord, please have mercy. They should have fired me 17 years ago. I'm 3 weeks away from retirement. Lord, have mercy. Hallelujah, somebody. Your boo still fooling with you, you need to tell the Lord, Lord, have mercy. I know they should have been gone. Have mercy. Don't give me what I do deserve. That's what we really need to be asking God for each and every day, for mercy, because there's a whole lot that we do deserve. But he's full of it, y'all. He's full of love, and he's full of light, and he's full of grace, and he's full of mercy. The Hebrew writer says that we can approach the throne of grace boldly. And there we can find grace and mercy to help us in our time of need. And when do you need grace and mercy? High five neighbors, say, every doggone day. Oh, you thought you didn't need it on Monday? On Tuesday? You thought you just needed it to come get a recharge every Sunday? No, brother. No, baby, you need grace and mercy every day of your natural born life. I know you don't believe me. You got your Bibles open, don't you? You got your Bibles open, don't you? Go to verse 16. Verse 16. I don't know if they can figure that out up there. Oh, you did. Thank you. Because I didn't even tell them that, but hallelujah. From his fullness, we have all received grace. I'm about to sit down because y'all drive me crazy. Grace on top of grace. In the original language, it means grace in the place of grace. What? That's what it means in the original language, grace in the place of grace. So the grace that I need really changes what I don't deserve right here. Something over here will supersede that. So essentially, just like your Christmas gifts keep getting better every year, I don't know because of modernism. I don't know if it's because of the money that's spent on it. But they keep getting better every year, right? Grace keeps getting better. You want to know why? It keeps getting better because you understand it better by and by. Hallelujah, somebody. Touch your neighbor and say, thank God for his grace. That being the case about Jesus, on Calvary, God gave Jesus what he didn't deserve. And on Calvary, God didn't give Jesus what he did deserve. The best of men died for the worst of men. The righteous died for the unrighteous. It was really lopsided. Hallelujah, somebody. God not giving Jesus what he did deserve and giving him what he didn't deserve. That's a great gift. Brothers and sisters, an active, dedicated, hardworking church member died. Unfortunately, that's what we all must do. He approached the pearly gates and he noticed a sign reading, entrance requirement is 1,000 points. So when St. Peter appeared, the man asked, how do you get the points? Peter said, well, what good things have you done in your life? So the man said, I was an immersed believer. I was born again. He said that I was water baptized, Holy Ghost filled, blood washed, and sanctified in Jesus Christ for 32 years until the day I died. He said, I didn't miss service. In 14 years straight, perfect attendance. I taught Sunday school for more than 12 years. Peter said, wonderful. That's 1 point. Now the man looked at Peter like some of y'all looking at me right now. He gulped and he said, well, nervously, I tithe of my income every time I got a raise. God got a raise. I served on the finance committee, and I was a man of integrity. I even served on the building committee. You know, you saw the wings that we added. We saw the improvements that we made. He said, I was even an elder. The pastor ordained me an elder in the church. If they ever had a prayer breakfast, a luncheon, or a dinner, I was right there. They knew they could count on me to set up tables and unfold chairs, and I even occasionally ran errands for the pastor himself. Peter said, wonderful. That's worth 1 point. So the man is now perspiring, wrenching his hands together, and he said, I recruited people for the church. I was always inviting visitors to come, and even some of them joined the church. I knew everybody in the church by face and name. I always tried to make everybody feel welcome, everybody feel special. I took the kids to Great America and on camping and fishing trips. And Peter Job, he said, great. It's wonderful. Now you got 3 points. Worry began to show all over the man's face. He was petrified, even becoming pale. And with a note of resignation, he said, that entrance exam is awfully tough. I don't believe that anybody could reach it without grace. Peter said, that's worth 997 points. That's all that is required. It's for us to have grace. When you have the grace of God, you meet all of the entrance requirements. Because nobody can get into heaven without the grace of God as demonstrated in the love of Jesus Christ. Jesus is the road. He is the pathway. He is the door. He said that I am the way. He said that I am the gate. We are saved by his works, not our works. By grace, we are saved through faith. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. That is why the Bible says, Hebrews 4:16, I already told you, we can then approach the throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. 2 Corinthians 12:9 says, but he said to me, my grace, y'all not helping me today. It's sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses so that Christ's power rests on me. Titus 2:11-12 says, for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age. And then John 1:16-17 says, for the fullness of his grace, we have all received one blessing after another. For the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Thank God for the gift. He's the greatest gift by value and what he possessed. Think about gifts as you've received over the years and that you're going to receive on this year. Several things take place. Number one, gifts that you receive, you may not like it because the person don't know you as well as they think they know you. And even though they have well intentions, everyone seems to hide behind the thought that it's the thought that counts. So they give you a gift that doesn't fit your personality. Amen. You might be allergic to it. They give you a cat toy. You don't even have a cat. I thought you had a cat. Rules right there. You don't know nothing about me. Amen, somebody. Give you costume jewelry and ask you why you don't wear it because you don't want your neck to turn green. Holler back at me if you're in here. You've all seen them. And then there's some people that just love to make stuff. Amen, somebody. They love to make your stuff. Love to watch them shows on TV. And they love to take ideas from Better Homes and God. Now go to the store and buy me something. Don't make me. They made it already. It's at Macy's. It's at Nordstrom. They made it already. I don't care if it is made in China. They made it. Amen. I'm just kidding. And so we kind of reject gifts based on some of those things, right? And then now some people are shrewd. When they do buy you something, they include a gift receipt. The cashier will ask you, because they know it's Christmas time, would you like a gift receipt? To say no would be grand. Amen. Amen. It would be grand, suggesting that you know this person to a T and they wouldn't dare exchange or return the gift you purchased for them. But that gift receipt says one thing, it could be too little. Could be too large. They may have one already. Did you ever think about that? They may have one already. Or they may just not like it. I've received gifts, I'm going to be honest, I don't like it. And I be waiting on people to ask me, why you ain't what? Because I don't like it. Because being honest will prevent it from happening a second time, them giving me something I do not like. Ain't no saying in saying I don't like it. Amen. It's a saying in lying and saying, I forgot I had. That's a lie. You done said it. are you pretty universal? Because you can go get what you want with the gift card, right? All these things are optional, and no one can force any such gift upon you. But God is so gracious, and God is so good that he was obligated to offer this gift for you. That's just proof in the pudding, proof of God's love. God demonstrated his love toward us, Romans 5 and 8 stuff, that while we were imperfect, while we were liars, while we were whoremongers, while we were cheaters, while we were fornicating, while we was getting high, while we was dropping it like it was hot, bagging anything up, while we was nay-naying and twerking, gambling and rambling. Hallelujah, somebody. Snorting and snipping. Puffing and passing. I'm on your road yet. I keep going until I get there. Christ died for us. Now, what other demonstration do you require other than that? He was obligated to offer this gift toward us, and then God is so good and God is so gracious that he gives you the option of accepting or rejecting, of accepting or rejecting his gift. Amen, somebody. Gives you that option. So it's entirely up to you. Anybody is condemned, spend eternity in the place other than heaven. You know what that is. God, I know I got a cussing problem. I know hell is in the Bible. See, I done said it. I'm cussed. Amen. I know hell is in the Bible, but you all know. Hallelujah. If you don't go to heaven, you automatically go where? Thank you. You don't go to hell because of what you do. One goes because of what they do not do, and that is accepting the gift of God through Jesus Christ. It's your option to accept or to reject, but it's our option to invite or to extend. I'm in the invitation already. Y'all don't even know it. Because he's the greatest gift to the world. He's the greatest gift by venue of where he was placed. He's the greatest gift by virtue of what he presented. He's the greatest gift by value in what he possessed. And that's why John 3:16 gives it to us like this. For God, the greatest lover, so loved, the greatest degree, the world, the greatest company, that he gave the greatest act, his only begotten Son, the greatest gift, that whosoever, the greatest opportunity, believes, the greatest simplicity in him, greatest attraction, should not perish, the greatest promise, but the greatest difference. They shall have the greatest certainty, everlasting life, the greatest possession. Be not dismayed. Whatever betide, God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love abide. God will take care of you. Is there anybody here that know he will? If you know he will, shout yes. Yes. The invitation is extended. If you're really grateful to God for your salvation, raise your hand. Raise your hand and encourage somebody in front of you, behind you, beside you. I'm so glad I'm saved. God will take care of you. Is there one today that wants to accept the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in the pardon of your sins? Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he's near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous his thoughts, and let him turn unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him and abundantly pardon. Hallelujah. Somebody give God some praise for this young lady who is coming today. There's still time for others to come. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be added unto you. God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that through him the world might be saved. You can be saved right here and right now. The Bible says you confess with your mouth, believe in your heart the Lord Jesus, that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. For whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And if you're not saved, that's what we want you to do. We want you, before you unwrap anything several days from now, we want you to unwrap what God has already sent you in the person of his son, Jesus Christ. Because the gifts that you've received in the past become obsolete. You've probably given them away. Probably don't even use them anymore. The same thing will happen to the gifts you will receive on this year. But the gift of salvation is eternal. And you appreciate it from day to day, from grace to grace, by and by. Hallelujah. Let us pray. God, we thank you for this day, this time of sharing. Thank you for your word. Thank you for these worshipers. We pray, Lord God, that your word accomplishes everything you intend for it to do. Let it not return unto you void, but let it accomplish what you please in the life of the hearer. There's somebody here today, Lord, that has the faith. Demonstrate to them that you have the power, Lord God, to draw them to the cross of Calvary, where they can discover, oh, so great a salvation. Save a sinner near as hell. Even reclaim a backslider. Add unto the body of Christ those you are saving. We pray, oh God, in the name of Jesus, that you do it for your power and for your purpose and your end, we pray. Thank you. Amen. If there's somebody here today that wants to be united with the family of God, the body of Christ, we're not just soliciting you for church membership, but we want you to be members of the body of Christ. We want you to share dual citizenship status.